can you allow me to share my screen? Now, similarity and plagiarism, you know, as I said, all similarities are not plagiarism. There are exclusions, there are exceptions, and those exceptions or exclusions we just discussed in detail. Say, for example, you know, when you do literature review, okay, obviously you take a lot of things from other source. And when you take, obviously, there is bound to have some similarity. But if you have given citation, if you have given proper references, then there is no problem, okay? Though that will not be plagiarism. But if you have not, that will just be similarity. But if you don't cite, if you know, if you show to the world that it is your own idea or work without acknowledging the original source, then that will be considered as plagiarism. So this is the basic difference between these two.
Thank you, sir. You may proceed for further session.
Okay, so you know, on this screen, I think we stopped. So I mean, you know, we should know the rules and regulations quite well so that we do not regret just because of lack of some knowledge of any rules and regulation. Now, if you see UGC regulation, then these are the levels of plagiarism and these are the penalties in case of thesis, you know, which students submit, thesis or dissertations. So UGC has categorized these levels into four levels, 0 to 3. And it says, you know, if similarity is up to 10%, then there's no penalty because it is considered as minor similarities. If it is between 10 to 40%, then such a student shall be asked to submit a revised script within a stipulated time period, not exceeding 6 months. Then if this similarity is between 40 to 60%, then such a student shall be debarred from submitting a revised script for a period of 1 year. And if it is above 60%, then such a student's registration shall be canceled. So this is for students. Now, if you see cases where degree has already been granted, then you know such degrees or benefit can be put in abeyance for a period as you know approved by the head of the institution. And then you know the next slide which I'll be going is related to the penalties in case of plagiarism in academic and research publications, which primarily applies to faculty members. And here, up to 10%, there is no penalty because it is considered as minor similarities. But what I said, you know, just a few minutes back, that it should not happen that that 10% is the central theme of someone else's work. Okay, and this generally happens in case of fictions. Then similarities up to 10 to 40%, then the faculty will be asked to withdraw manuscript. If it is between 40 to 60, then the faculty shall be asked to withdraw manuscript, shall be denied a right to one annual increment, shall not be allowed to be a supervisor to any new master's, PhD, MPhil student for a period of 2 years. And if it crosses 60%, then you know it will be two increments will be denied, and the PhD supervisor things should be snatched for a period of 3 years. So this is the these are all quantitative. You know, if the percentage is so, then this will be the punishment. And if there are repeated plagiarism by any faculty or staff of level three, okay, level three is what? Above 60%, then you know such staff or faculty can even be terminated by the higher education institution. So that is the maximum punishment which a faculty or staff gets if he or she indulges in any plagiarism or any such thing. Now, you know, can a faculty, you know, these are some cases from my previous organization, so I thought I should discuss these here. Can a faculty or a staff be punished for plagiarizing if his or her work has not been published anywhere? Now, say, for example, you know, if I write an article, okay, that and I disclose to the university that my article has been accepted and I'm going to present this article in any conference or I'm going to or say if I want some funding, then, you know, if I ask my university or institution to give me funds on the basis of that paper, and if my university comes to know that that paper was plagiarized, even then, you know, university can take action, though it has not been published. And why and how university can take action? Because the UGC regulation provides for it. UGC regulation says, when it talks of definition of a script, it says script includes a research paper, thesis, dissertations, chapter in books, full-fledged books, and any other similar work submitted for assessment / opinion. So even if you submit some document for assessment or opinion, even then, you know, you can be punished. So what is the best option? You know, I understand, you know, there could be cases where any university wants to somehow punish someone and it just looks for some kind of excuse. And if the university gets such excuse, obviously they have the right to punish you. So it is better that, you know, whenever you send any article to the university for any kind of funding, etc., make sure that you check your article in Turnitin or any other software that you might have. But at the same time, you know, I always recommend that you should not just check in any software, because there could be some open source or open access which are available in public domain softwares where the repository of that software or database may not be that rich. So it is better to check your paper in Turnitin. Those who want a user ID and password of Turnitin, I will be very happy to provide. So you just need to send an email to us and we will provide you the user ID and password on the same day. And you know, I would say, you know, just to check this plagiarism, UGC has also suggested two committees. One is departmental committee and the other is institutional committee. And their names are DAIP and IAIP. DAIP is basically departmental academic integrity panel, and institutional level panel is called institutional academic integrity panel. And this is the composition of members which you see on the left hand side and the right hand side. But what happens sometimes, you know, like for example, in our departments, there are no departmental level committee. So it will be good that if every department head can just recommend a committee to the head of the institution, so that if there is any case of plagiarism in their department, they can tackle that case. But it does not mean that a case which is a departmental level cannot be investigated by institutional academic integrity panel. You know, it can override, the IAIP can override the DIP's right to investigate. And it can take up some cases on suo motu basis, you know, on its own, it can decide to, you know, take up some case. So these are two panels which actually look into such cases. You know, there was a case in one of the places where a faculty was found to have plagiarized in a book. And that faculty, you know, when that faculty was punished, that faculty said, you know, how can you punish me? You know, I took approval from the vice chancellor of my manuscript. But, you know, the vice chancellor is not the author. So you are the author. So you will be responsible for whatever you do. And there is a definition of author also in the UGC guide regulation, which says author includes a student or a faculty or a researcher or a staff of higher education institution who claims to be the creator of the work under consideration. So if you are claiming that you are the creator of that work, obviously you will be held responsible for whatever you publish, whether vice chancellor approved it or registrar or PVC, whatever. Now, secondly, you know, some people, you know, in the past said that, you know, mine is a very scholarly work, because my book or my book or some other document was purchased by Oxford University and Cambridge University. How can you, you know, say that this is a plagiarized document? So I think that those excuses cannot be taken as, because there's a possibility, you know, that university or Oxford University Press or any, sorry, not press, Oxford University has purchased your book, but that does not mean that, you know, it may not have any plagiarism in that. So that is that thing I thought I must indicate that also. There is some confusion about, you know, copyright infringement and plagiarism. So copyright infringement is basically using someone else's work without obtaining their permission. And when we talk of plagiarism, you know, when you don't cite, so that is plagiarism. And in case of copyright infringement, affected party lodges the complaint. Say, for example, if you have violated copyright or if you have any copyright infringement of my work, I can lodge a complaint. But, you know, if you plagiarize, then anybody can go and complain about you. So that is there. This is another difference between these two. The third is the copyright infringement cases are taken up by the court of law, whereas, you know, the plagiarism cases are taken up by these bodies, which I just suggested, that is DAIP and AIP. In case of copyright, you know, it comes under criminal law, and there is a punishment, you know, even imprisonment, and that imprisonment is rigorous imprisonment, which means you have to work, and it also involves compensation. Whereas in case of plagiarism, you know, in extreme cases of, you know, plagiarism, that is what I said, level repeated plagiarism of level 3, at the most you can be terminated. So these are the basic differences between copyright infringement and plagiarism, which I thought I must tell you. And as I said earlier also, that most of the cases of plagiarism can be avoided by citing relevant sources. So it's extremely important for us to understand what are citation, what are references, what are bibliographies. I'm assuming that you all know what are citations, what are references, and what is bibliography. So I will not just go into these details. I'll just skip. I can skip all these things, right? Or I have to tell Professor Farida or Dr. Nagaraju?
Please go ahead. It's important.
Okay. So citation means, you know, citation or in-text citation is when one paper refers to another. You must have seen that in different research articles, there is a bracket, the author's last name and then year. So that is called citation or in-text citation. Reference means, you know, the complete detail of that citation. What is the title? What is the author? Who is the author? When it was published? Who published it? Where it was published? So that is the complete detail. There is some that is called reference. So there's something called bibliography. So the basic difference between bibliography and references is that references are those documents which you have actually referred in your document. Whereas bibliography is, you know, the list of all the documents which you might have read during the course of your research, which you may or may not have referred in your research work. So this is the basic difference. Now, just by example, let me just say that, you know, this is the citation. You know, I wrote an article and then this was a government document. So this is how, you know, a citation of government document. This is actually Administrative Reforms and Public Grievances Department of Ministry, where, you know, it was published in 2012. So this is how I gave the citation. I said, despite established record retention schedule of the Government of India, and those record retention schedule basically are these record retention schedule of this particular citation. And if you see the complete reference, then complete reference is this, okay? Administrative Reforms and Public Grievances Department of, it was published in 2012, Government of India Record Retention. This is the complete title. And then, you know, it was published in New Delhi. So all the information is here, okay? So this is the citation and this is the complete reference. Now when we say next type of citation, then this particular, you know, this is the last name of the author and it is it was published in 1991. And this is the complete reference. So in this reference, you know, it is a little different from this reference. Rendering is completely different because one is that it is a journal article, okay, which was available on this particular website. Okay, you see the URL and it was retrieved on this particular day, okay, May 8, 2016. And why it is important to write date, because there's a possibility that tomorrow this site may not exist. So giving date of retrieving this particular document is very important. And then, you know, the issue number, et cetera, all these things you find here. There are a lot of, you know, standards, or you can say formats of these giving citations and references. So I'm sure you all be knowing about APA. Similarly, you know, there are other formats also given by Oxford, Harvard, Nature. These are called, I mean, these are some of the formats or standards. Then IEEE, generally, you know, in science subjects, IEEE is used, whereas in humanities, APA is used. So, and every system has a different style of rendering. Now, say, for example, you know, if I am taking something from a book, okay, then, and this is the particular thing which I have taken from a book, that libraries are lifeline of any academic institution. You know, these are just examples of, that is why I have, this is, you can say this is common knowledge, okay? But still, you know, I have here trying to explain you by example. This is the citation I gave. You know, I have taken from a book which was authored by, the author's last name was Parvez, and which was published in 2017. So this is how I will cite a source from a book. And this is how I will actually give the complete reference. So Parvez A, I mean, the initial of first name and the last name will be first. Year will be written like this, then Information Seeking Behavior and Insight into Indian Financial Industry is the title of the book. It was published in New Delhi by this publisher. Okay, so this is for book. Now, similarly, if it is a book chapter, and if I'm consulting a book, some material from a book chapter, then say research on Islam cannot be completed unless a researcher visits India and consults libraries, including AMU, JMU, etc., etc. So this is, you know, these are the three authors, last name of all the three authors, this, and this is the year. Now, remember, you know, this is I have taken it from a book chapter. So book chapter means there is a book and written by few or one editor. And inside that book, there are a lot of chapters which are contributed by different authors. So here, you know, this first, I will write the detail of that article by authors, okay? And this article is published where? It is published in a different edited book. So this writing of this in is important here. And this book is edited by so-and-so people. And this was the title of that book. And on this page number, this particular article was there. And this is the place of publication and book and the publisher. So, you know, similarly, there are a lot of things which there are a lot of styles available, and every, you know, when you take something from website, style is different. If you take from newspaper, it is different. So there are a lot of styles, and it becomes extremely, extremely difficult for us to remember all these things. Okay. So how we should do, what we should do. So it is the technology which can always help us in, you know, getting over all these issues. So when I say technology, you know, I mean that, you know, what we discussed in the beginning about UGC regulation, that these are the core areas. Now, when I say core areas, which means there will not be any similarities except those exclusions which I discussed initially. But what I have done here is on the right-hand side, you know, I always feel that these things for example, creating a table of content, pagination, track change, footnote, endnote, figures, tables, preparing questionnaire, giving references or bibliography, these things can be assigned to technology. And if you assign this technology, what will happen? You will be able to focus more on these areas than unnecessarily wasting time on this. And, you know, giving references or citations manually is extremely, extremely painful. And those who have, gone through this process of, you know, writing PhD thesis, they already know that, you know, if somebody gives table of content after checking the pages, etc., in the thesis, and if some insertions are there, additional insertions, then the whole, pagination get disturbed. So it is important that we use technology. And what is track change mode? I think a lot of faculty members, I find are young, so they perhaps maybe knowing all these track change mode, etc. So, but I will still try to, explain some of the things with a brief demonstration. So I'll skip these, but you know, this is a very important reference organizer, which is Mendeley, and this also probably I will tell you by some examples. So, but yes, if I'm not able to tell you about this Mendeley, so what you can do, you can go to my YouTube channel, and you can see this particular video, that is Mendeley, and you know, you will have a lot of clarity about how we can use a reference organizer. So what I will do, okay, then we'll not discuss much about now ethical aspect. We will simply, but yes, you can always see these documents after, I mean, whenever you get time, which discuss various, you know, issues related to scholarly integrity or academic integrity. You know, Wiley probably may have a different way of, you know, understanding of this academic ethics. So these are some, okay, so what we have done is here, you know, in Manu, I'm not sure whether it is available on the website. If it is not available in the website, I'll be very happy to, you know, forward a copy of this particular thing to you. That is Manu Code of Ethics in Research and Publications. So you should go through this document once, and not just this document. I will suggest that you please go through that UGC regulation also. So this is a very lengthy document of UGC. So I would not suggest that you go through this document now, but at least this UGC regulation and this particular document that, you know, I mean, we have created here, you can just go through and see this. Okay. So I'll, yeah, there is a website which, you know, keeps a track on all retractions. So what are the retractions? Retraction is basically when some paper is submitted and it is retracted for some reason. Sometimes authors may ask publishers to remove that article. Sometimes publishers do it because of plagiarism or something else. So this is a good website. And if you get some time, please go and see this. You know, I was trying to search some you know, documents here. I was searching, you know, in architecture, how many articles have been retracted. So these 2-3 articles I got from this website. And it was just out of curiosity. I thought I will just see these documents. Maybe the curiosity was because my daughter is in architecture. So I thought I will see what are the papers. So anyway, I will just show you something, you know, practically. What I was trying to say, just a second. So you are able to see my Word document?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, you know, one way of giving a citation is, of course, MS Office Word. It is very simple. Say, for example, I decide to give a citation here. Okay, then what I will do. So what I would, I'll just copy it and create a new document. One second. So this is, say, a document, and here I want to give citation. So what I will do is I'll go to references. You know, there are two important tabs in MS Office Word, references. So if I go to references, so here I, you know, get insert citation. So what I will do, if I click here, so I'll get this worksheet. So it says type of source. So if I'm, you know, say for example, if I use a book, if I'm citing something from a book, I write here, you know, the author's name, just assuming it is Akhtar Parvez, and then title is, say, Librarianship in India, or the city is New Delhi, publisher is, say, Sage. It was published 2019. Okay. So if I say okay here, so what you see, this one has come, okay? And this one has come, this is IEEE style. And why it is this IEEE style is coming? Because here this is the default in my MS Office Word. So what I will do, instead of IEEE, I will choose APA. So if I choose APA, you know, this change to APA style. Okay, now similarly, you know, I will give another citation, and this time the citation is maybe I'm taking something from a, say from a journal article, article in journal. Say here, if I write, okay, so the author is, say, for example, Farida Siddiqui, and the title is, say, Indian Labor, okay, and if it is published in, say, Journal of Labor, okay, Labor and Manpower, and it was published in 2017, okay, and it is on page number, this particular article from where I am taking something is in on page number 10 to 22, and if I say okay here, so you know this citation has come, right? So it is also visible to all of you. Now if I want to give references of you know, I'll just write references here, and I'll go here, and there is a button called bibliography. So I'll just click on that, and then I'll say here, so what has happened here, you know, so the references have come. Okay, so I'm sure it is all visible to you. So here you really don't have to remember anything. Now say if you have used API style, and you have sent this article for publication to some publisher, and that publisher says, okay, you will have to change all your citations and the references in IEEE style. So what you simply need to do is you go here and just say IEEE. So it is changed, okay? So this is what you can do. You can convert this into any other style, say MLA or whatever style. So that is quite easy. So here, you know, you save a lot of time. That is very important. Secondly, you know, it is COVID time and a lot of things are being done online. I mean, checking thesis, you know, gone are the days when, you know, the at least for a limited time, when the researcher used to come to you, sit with you, and you used to explain everything. So my suggestion is that maybe, you know, we should use the track change mode so that it is good for you as supervisor and for a student. So here there is a, you know, here there is a, one second, I think there is some. Yeah, here there is a button called review. So if I type review, and if I, there's a button called track change. So if I just switch it on, okay. So what will happen, you know, whatever I write here, it will get visible to other students. Say if I say, for example, essential, I'm deleting. Okay. I feel as a supervisor that essential is not the right word which my student has used. So I will use important. Okay. Function, okay, I say it should be functions, not, I mean, just to give you some examples. Now, if I find that spelling of organization is wrong, I should write like this. So all, you know, whatever, and here I feel, you know, this needs to be deleted. And then here I find that, you know, he has referred Professor Farida Siddiqui's article. So what I will, I can always give a comment here. I can go to new comment, and here I can, here I'll also, so please, I'll make a remark for my student. Please also check Dr. Majid's article on this issue, okay? So what happens that, you know, you do all changes in a Word document. And when you sit with your student, you tell him 100 things, but I'm sure you must be experiencing that out of those 100, he will execute only maybe 50, 60, 70, 30 he may forget. But if you make everything, you know, here, if you record everything, it will be easier for the student also. And once these this paper goes back or this file goes back to the student, student has the option of either accepting or rejecting your changes. So this is the particular button for that. And then if a student makes any changes in it, then whatever changes the student will make, that will be in different color, not in this red color. So when the file will come back to you, you know what changes I had done and what the student has done. So it becomes quite easy. Now, but I always say that, this is giving a lot of citations and references is not as good as using some reference organizer. And as I had suggested, you should use some reference organizer. And I use Mendeley reference organizer, which let me just show you what I'll briefly tell you. I'll take another 5-7 minutes. And then, but yes, you must see that video on Mendeley. So here what happens, the good thing about Mendeley is that, I will tell you how I sometimes read a particular topic. Now, there could be a time when I'm not interested in reading the whole complete article. So what I will do, I will identify some articles and by reading their abstract and start putting those articles in this particular dashboard. So there are a lot of, these folders I've created. You know, when I was working on digital study, this is e-resources. Then on ethical writing, I save all my documents like this so that, whenever I want to cite from here, it becomes extremely important. It becomes extremely easy. How it does become extremely important, let me just show you. Say, for example, here I want to cite, okay? So what I will do, I'll go to references and here I have Mendeley. So this Mendeley is there because I have created a plugin. So once you see my video, you will be able to understand. So if I say here, just insert citation and I say, go to Mendeley, for example, this particular document. And here I say cite. So when I say cite, automatically this thing has, this citation has come. And the good thing about Mendeley is, what we saw in MS Office Word that we were opening a for giving citations, we were actually typing everything, the author, title, etc. But here, if you have a PDF article, if you drag that particular article into the dashboard of Mendeley, automatically all the bibliographic description like author, title, place of publication, publisher, abstract, volume, number, etc. Everything will be captured automatically here. So that is the advantage of Mendeley. So I will not go into the, the nitty-gritties of Mendeley. But yes, if you really want to, if you really want that, you should focus just on your research rather than, doing all these things manually, then I think you must see that video. And if you still have any question or doubt, I think you all are you are from Manu communities, you can always call me, we can always discuss on phone, or you can send me an email. But before that, I would suggest that you please see the video. Let me also briefly show you, I think for Turnitin also, how Turnitin works. I think for that also, you can send me an email. I will just tell you which video to watch so that you understand how this, what is that? Turnitin is used. So I think with this, I finish my thing and I'll be very happy if there are questions. I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you so much, sir. Now floor is open for questions. So I request the participants to ask questions if you have. So before that, sir, I would like to ask a question.
Sure.
That, for example, a research scholar or a teacher publishes his or her article in UGC CARE journal. After 3 or 4 months, that journal is removed from the list. So that can be considered for CAS for teachers?
No, I think, if you see there were two things, you know, what UGC did. Initially, when UGC came out with the list of 38,000, 39,000, so it did not clarify anything about those journals, you know, where we might have published. So it didn't say anything. But when it removed 4,000 journals, I think in 2018 or 19, that time it gave a clarification saying that articles published prior to that date will be considered for all promotions, etc. So it all depends, you know, how UGC, you know, if they clarify, it is good. Sometimes initially, first time they did not clarify, but probably they learned a lesson next time when they removed some journals. And so I think it all depends how UGC treats it. But when you apply for CAS, so you say that I have published in a journal and that a journal has already been removed by the UGC. So you have to put some paper inside saying that, you know, this journal was there earlier. So you on UGC's side, there is always a, I think, journal number. So that journal number, and if possible, keep a print a copy of that UGC's page where that journal was being reflected. Also, you know, sometimes what happens that when you apply for CAS, the journal does not reflect that it is a peer-reviewed journal or not. Neither sometimes website says it is a peer-reviewed journal. So if you have published in a peer-reviewed journal where, you know, nowhere it is reflected it's a peer-reviewed journal, the good thing would be that you take a letter from the publisher declaring that it is a peer-reviewed journal and put that in the CAS application. What happens when you apply for CAS, the screening committee, you know, they, I mean, sometimes don't take much effort. So whatever you have said, you know, in your document, they will take it as it is. So my suggestion is to you is that, you know, it's always good to give proper complete application so that if they have said, so that, you know, they don't have any kind of doubt about your application, what you want to say. Yes, sir. I think.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. I think.
Sir, yes, I have one more question.
Yes. Please ask. Yes, ma'am. Please ask me.
Sir, जैसे अभी आपने रेफरेंस के बारे में बताया, तो मतलब मुझे मेरे ही किसी प्रीवियस पेपर में से अगर मुझे कुछ पैराग्राफ लिखना है, सपोज आई राइट अबाउट सोशल मीडिया के बारे में मैंने कुछ लिखा अपने पिछले पेपर में, और अब मुझे उसमें से ही कुछ एक पैराग्राफ मुझे
आप अपने आप को साइट कर दीजिए.
अच्छा, दैट्स इट.
यस, लेकिन देखिए,
ओके,
सेल्फ साइटेशंस बहुत ज्यादा भी नहीं होने चाहिए. मतलब ऐसा ना हो कि क्योंकि आप इसलिए साइट कर रही हैं कि आप क्योंकि अपने साइटेशन बढ़ाना चाहती हैं, वो चीज वैसी वो वैसा भी नहीं होना चाहिए. लेकिन हाँ, जहाँ जेन्युइनली जरूरत है आपको बिल्कुल करना चाहिए. और देखिए, मैंने जरार साहब है, इनका मैं एक मैसेज देख रहा था, उन्होंने लिखा है कि मेंडले इज सो गुड, तो ये यूज करते हैं और मैंने मुझे बड़ी खुशी यूज करते हैं. ऐसे हमारे बहुत सारे जो स्टूडेंट जो यहाँ से जिन्होंने PhD की इन्होंने यूज किया, वो काफी खुश हैं इससे. ना सिर्फ जरार बल्कि और लोग भी हैं. और एक और, व्हाई इज इट सो शाहीन परवीन सो इम्पोर्टेंट टू टीच एथिक्स एंड वैल्यू टू द गुड रिसर्च. देखिए, मेरे ख्याल से एथिक्स तो सिर्फ, अब मैं आपको अपने, मैं आई एम इंदौर में था पहले, तो MBA लेवल पे जब हमारे वहाँ जब एडमिशन्स होते हैं तो MBA लेवल पे भी एथिक्स पढ़ाया जाता है. तो अब जाहिर है ऐसा तो हो नहीं सकता कि सिर्फ 2 साल उनको MBA में एथिक्स पढ़ाने से उनको एथिक्स या एथिकल हो जाएंगे. वो ये चीज़ तो शुरू से होती है इंसान में. तो मेरे ख्याल से एथिक्स तो बहुत ही ज़रूरी चीज़ है जो हम सबको ही फॉलो करनी चाहिए. एंड आई थिंक इट इज़, I think we learn these ethics from our childhood, if I'm right.
Hello.
Yes. Hello.
Sir, with this side from Manu Polytechnic, Cuttack campus. एक क्वेश्चन आप पूछा था अभी फर्स्ट सेशन के बाद. एक क्वेश्चन और है सर. पहले तो बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया सर, बहुत अच्छा और बहुत हेल्दी सेशन रहा आपका, बहुत ही फ्रूटफुल सेशन है ये. सर, एक डाउट था ये कि जैसे बहुत सारे पेपर्स हम जो कॉन्फ्रेंस में सबमिट करते हैं, वो पेपर कॉन्फ्रेंस के थ्रू जर्नल्स में आ जाते हैं, तो पेपर जो है टेस्ट में वो जर्नल्स में काउंट होंगे या कॉन्फ्रेंस में काउंट होंगे?
देखिए, पहली चीज तो ये है यूसुफ साहब के आप एक ही जगह पब्लिश कर सकते हैं अपना एक आर्टिकल, चाहे वो जर्नल हो चाहे वो कॉन्फ्रेंस प्रोसीडिंग हो। लेकिन ये जरूर है कि अगर मान लीजिए आपका कॉन्फ्रेंस प्रोसीडिंग में छपा और आपने उसमें फिर बहुत सारे इम्प्रूवमेंट किए और उसके बाद वो फिर आप उसे जर्नल में छाप सकते हैं। लेकिन ऐसा नहीं हो सकता एक ही आप आर्टिकल, एक ही रिसर्च आर्टिकल आप दो जगह छाप दें सेम चीज।
नहीं सर, सॉरी क्वेश्चन, ये जो कॉन्फ्रेंस टीम होती है वो पहले प्रोसीडिंग में पब्लिश करती है, फिर बाद में उसी पेपर्स को खुद वो लोग भेजते हैं, सबमिट करते हैं जर्नल्स में।
लेकिन सर उसमें देखिए, उसमें वो एज इट इज नहीं करना चाहिए, वो उसमें बहुत सारे चेंजेस होने चाहिए। ऐसा ना हो कि वो एज इट इज छप जाए। अगर एज इट इज छप जाए तो इसका मतलब आपने एक ही आर्टिकल दो जगह छापा है।
तो कॉन्फ्रेंस की टीम को इसी चीज माइंड करनी चाहिए ना, क्योंकि वो तो टीम जो है वो सब सारी चीजों को एथिकल जो भी रूल्स होते हैं वो सब फॉलो करते हैं वो लोग।
सर देखिए,
ऑर्गेनाइजिंग टीम होती है।
सर देखिए, इंडिया में जो एक तो मैंने आप लोगों को भी थोड़ी देर पहले बताया था प्रेटरी जर्नल्स और पब्लिशर्स, इसके अलावा जो इंडिया में प्रेटरी कॉन्फ्रेंसेज बहुत सारी होती हैं। आप सब आप अच्छी तरह से जानते हैं किस तरह की प्रेटरी कॉन्फ्रेंसेज होती हैं। आप जो भी लिख दीजिए वो छाप देंगे, है ना। तो मेरा उससे मशवरा ये है कि अगर आप कॉन्फ्रेंस में अपना छपवा रहे हैं तो अपने आर्टिकल की पूरी चीज मत छपाइए, थोड़ी बहुत छपाइए, उसको थोड़ा सा और इम्प्रूव कीजिए और उसके बाद जर्नल में छापिए। क्योंकि जर्नल में ज्यादा आपको मार्क्स मिलेंगे बनिस्बत कॉन्फ्रेंस।
सर एक क्वेश्चन और है, अगर आप इजाजत दें।
बिल्कुल सर।
जैसे अगर टर्निटिंग पे हम कोई सिमिलैरिटी चेक करते हैं किसी पेपर का और अगर भूल जाते हैं वो नो रिपोजिटरी पे क्लिक करना, रिपोजिटरी में उनके आ जाएगा, तो क्या प्रोसीजर है फिर वो रिपोजिटरी से हटाने का?
देखिए उसका प्रोसीजर जो ये है कि पहली चीज तो ये कि जब भी आप पहली क्लास क्रिएट, जब भी कोई क्लास क्रिएट करते हो उसके अंदर, तो हमेशा उसमें नो रिपोजिटरी दे दीजिए नंबर वन। मान लीजिए आप भूल गए, आपका अभी कल का या परसों का भी एक केस है कि एक साहब के दो पेपर जो है उन्होंने डाले थे उसमें और दोनों जो है वो रिपोजिटरी का पार्ट बन गए। उसके बाद उन्होंने जब आर्टिकल थोड़ा ठीक करके दोबारा से अपलोड किया तो उसमें 97% आ रही थी, और वो इस वजह से आ रही थी क्योंकि जाहिर है कि पहले से उनका पेपर उसमें रिपोजिटरी में था। तो फिर उन्होंने क्या किया कि उन्होंने अपना आर्टिकल जो है ना वहाँ से डिलीट कर दिया टर्निटिन से। तो ये आर्टिकल वहाँ से डिलीट नहीं करना चाहिए, क्योंकि आपको अगर वो आर्टिकल डिलीट कराना है तो आपको उसकी आर्टिकल की सबमिशन आईडी जो है वो मुझे भेजनी पड़ेगी। और मैं टर्निटिन का एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर हूँ तो मैं यहाँ से वो आर्टिकल आपकी जो डिलीशन की रिक्वेस्ट है मैं टर्निटिन को भेजूंगा और टर्निटिन एक डेढ़ दिन में उसको डिलीट कर देता है। तो उसके बाद आप जब दोबारा डालेंगे तब वैसा नहीं होगा। लेकिन अच्छा, जब मैंने जैसा बताया कि वो साहब वो एक हमारे फैकल्टी है, उन्होंने गेस्ट फैकल्टी है, उन्होंने वो आर्टिकल उसमें से डिलीट कर दिया। उसके बाद फिर ये हुआ कि उसमें ज़रा टाइम ज़्यादा लग गया, टर्निटिन से कहना पड़ा कि वो जो उन्होंने डिलीट किए हैं आर्टिकल्स उसको आप रिस्टोर कीजिए। तो उन्होंने वो आर्टिकल्स रिस्टोर किए, उसका सबमिशन आईडी उनके पास आया और उन्होंने सबमिशन आईडी मुझे भेजा, उसके बाद वो जाके रिपोजिटरी से डिलीट हुआ। तो ये इसलिए मैं ये कह रहा था कि एक मेरा आप में से जो भी लोग इंटरेस्ट होंगे, आप इंटरेस्टेड होंगे, मुझे एक मेल भेज दीजिएगा तो जो सही वाला एक मतलब सारे वीडियो ठीक है लेकिन इसमें से एक जो डिटेल्ड वीडियो है टर्निटिन के बारे में वो मैं आप लोगों को इसका लिंक मेल कर दूंगा, वो आप पूरा देखिएगा जरा। वो थोड़ा लंबा है 1 घंटे का, लेकिन पूरा देखिएगा तो आपको अच्छे से टर्निटिन कैसे यूज करते हैं।
ओके सर, थैंक यू सर।
वेलकम सर। जी मैडम, जी मैडम,
जी हाँ सर, जी अस्सलाम वालेकुम सर। सर आपका सेशन काफी अच्छा रहा है और काफी फ्रूटफुल रहा हम लोगों के लिए। सर आपने काफी इस चीजों पर रोशनी डाली है, फॉल्सिफिकेशन, फैब्रिकेशन एंड प्लेगरिज्म। सर आपने एक चीज और बताई है, सलामी स्लाइसिंग। सर उसके बारे में थोड़ा और डिटेल में बता सकते हैं, उसका मतलब क्या होता है सर?
सलामी स्लाइसिंग का मतलब ये हुआ कि जैसे एक आर्टिकल मैंने लिखा और मैं अच्छी तरह से जानता हूँ कि वो उसको एक आर्टिकल ही बनेगा उसका, ऐसा नहीं हो सकता उस आर्टिकल के दो बन जाए। और मैं उसको दो आर्टिकल बना दूं उसको अननेसेसरली, तो वो गलत चीज है। हाँ, अगर वो दो आर्टिकल बनने के लायक है तो अलग चीज है, लेकिन अगर वो सिर्फ एक ही आर्टिकल बनने के लायक है तो मैं ये, मुझे ये नहीं करना चाहिए कि कुछ डेटा एक ही है, कुछ सेलेक्टिव डेटा एक में लूँ, दूसरा सेलेक्टिव डेटा दूसरे में लूँ। तो ऐसा ना हो कि एक एक आर्टिकल में एक चीज दिख रही हो और दूसरी चीज सामने ना आ रही हो, दूसरे आर्टिकल में वो दूसरी चीज दिख रही हो, पहली चीज सामने ना आ रही हो। इसमें आपको थोड़ा सा जजमेंट ये करना पड़ेगा कि वो एक ही आर्टिकल में पब्लिश होना चाहिए या उसके दो आर्टिकल बन सकते हैं। तो अगर वो नहीं बन सकते तो उसको अननेसेसरली बनाने की कोई जरूरत नहीं।
ओके, थैंक यू सर। जी सर,
सो इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस प्लीज आस्क सर।
जी परवेज साहब, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। बहुत ही उम्दा लेक्चर था, बेहद शुक्रिया, आपने हमारे इनविटेशन को एक्सेप्ट किया।
Did I have any option?
Of course you will, बिल्कुल आपको कोई ऑप्शन नहीं था, आपको आना ही था और मुझे शुक्रिया अदा करना ही था। बेहद शुक्रिया कि आपने एक्सेप्ट किया। बहुत ही आई एम हैप्पी दैट एट द इनिशियल स्टेज ऑफ द कैरियर आर यंग फैकल्टी मेंबर्स आर गेटिंग टू नो अबाउट ऑल दीज वेरी सेंसिटिव एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट इश्यूज ऑफ द एकेडमिक लाइफ। It was very important for me also. It was certain things I used to, I keep asking you about MS Word and, you know, Chicago style and all that. I have one question. You know, I was so happy. I have been missing for the last more than 20 years, a particular thing which I got today in your presentation. You know, when I was doing PhD and we used to go to NCR's library, we used to tell them that I need, there was Lakshman ji hua karte the wahan par, if you remember.
So I maine wahan kaam kiya kuch din,
isiliye main aapko naam bata rahi hu. So I used to tell him ki mujhe nationalized banks par chahiye material. So he used to give me a long list of 25 pages. You know, about the articles published on nationalized banks, nowhere I got that kind of facility. So, but the same type of list I saw in your presentation. How to get that that list? How did you prepare that? And how do they prepare that? Like, you know, we go to search engine and then we give the keyword and then there will be a list. Accordingly, you have to select. But the way you are selecting and keeping, you are keeping everything in one folder. Like you wanted something on plagiarism, so you are saving everything from written format to audio video thing also in on that particular thing. So how to do that?
I mean, to answer your question, you know, if say for example you are searching for some article on diminishing,
I want to search on financial inclusion, for instance.
Say then, you know, on financial inclusions, you know, if you, one way is that you go to our library website, and if you go to OPAC, you know, I will just show you. One second, I'll again share my screen. So I think other faculty members can also, you know, just see this. We have, you know, here there's a website called library.manu.edu. So agar aap ispe jayenge, to ispe, main isko zara slide, ispe dekhiye, काफी चीजें हैं, तो मैं इस पे आपको नीचे यहाँ पर देखिए, प्रिंट बुक्स हैं, ई बुक्स हैं, जर्नल्स एंड मैगजीन्स हैं, कौन कौन से आते हैं, रेयर बुक्स क्या है, ये सारी चीज़ें तो यहाँ पर रहें। और यहाँ पर मैं सारे फैकल्टी मेम्बर्स को बताना चाहता हूँ कि हमने यहाँ पर क्वेश्चन पेपर्स भी डाले हुए हैं, जो मानू के जो क्वेश्चन पेपर्स हैं, तो अगर किसी को चाहिए तो उसके लिए भी वो देख सकते हैं। दूसरा हमने जी दूसरा ये हमने इस पेज पे जो है वो लाइब्रेरी की वेबसाइट का भी देखिए एक लिंक है। तो अगर हम पहली चीज़ तो ये कि अगर हम यहाँ मान लीजिए टाइटल में सर्च करते हैं, मान लीजिए किताबें सर्च कर रहे हैं हमें ना, फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन, देखते हैं कुछ किताबें हैं हमारे पास के नहीं, तो देखिए इसमें कुछ किताबें आ गई है ना, तो ये किताबें तो जाहिर है। अच्छा इसमें आपको देखिए एक चीज़ जो ये आपने देखी होगी कि इसमें साथ में मैं ये देख रहा हूँ कोई ई बुक है कि नहीं, तो इसमें देखिए काफ़ी सारे किताबें ही मिल गई। ठीक है, आप यहाँ पर क्या कर सकते हैं अगर अपना आप यूज़र आईडी और पासवर्ड आपने क्रिएट किया हुआ है, तो ये चीज़ें आप ये यहाँ से चीज़ें कर करके आप या सेलेक्ट करके आप इसका एक इसके अलग से फाइल बना हाँ वो तो कर सकते हैं। उसके अलावा आप मैं वापस जाता हूँ और ये लाइब्रेरी वेबसाइट है देखिए है ना, यहाँ लाइब्रेरी वेबसाइट पे
सबसे पहले आप मुझे प्लीज सबसे पहले मैं यही बीच बीच में अपने सारे डाउट्स, मानू की यूनिवर्सिटी उसके लिए मुझे अलग से पासवर्ड और वगैरह लेना पड़ेगा?
देखिए आप हाँ देखिए
अगर मैं अपने उससे अपने अकाउंट से इंटरनेट पर आ जाती हूँ तो फिर आई कैन नॉट गो डायरेक्टली, आई कैन नॉट ओपन दिस लिंक?
नहीं आप देखिए जैसे ये वाला लाइब्रेरी का ये पे library.manu.edu पे आप आ गई, ठीक है, उसके बाद ये हमारा जो लाइब्रेरी का जो ओपैक है वो है ये इसमें। हाँ एक तो चीज ये है, दूसरी चीज ये है कि यहाँ से हमने लाइब्रेरी जो हमारी वेबसाइट है उसका लिंक ऑलरेडी एक दिया हुआ है, तो अगर आप इस लिंक पे ये लिंक खुलेगा और यहाँ पर अगर आप लेफ्ट साइड पे देखेंगे तो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक रिसोर्सेज एक तो ये है, ठीक है
जी जी ठीक
है। अगर आप इलेक्ट्रॉनिक रिसोर्सेज में जाएंगे और वहां पर मान लीजिए इकोनॉमिक एंड पॉलिटिकल वीकली है ना, अब इकोनॉमिक एंड पॉलिटिकल वीकली जब आप यहां से खोलेंगी तो अगर आप कैंपस के अंदर हैं तो इसका एक्सेस आपको ऑलरेडी मिल जाएगा, मतलब क्योंकि आईपी पर है हमारे। लेकिन अगर आप कैंपस से बाहर हैं जो लोग वो वर्चुअल प्राइवेट नेटवर्क के थ्रू यूज कर सकते हैं, तो जो ऐसे हमारे फैकल्टी हैं जिनको वीपीएन एक्सेस चाहिए वो हमें ईमेल कर दें। आजकल जरा पिछले एक आध हफ्ते से वीपीएन में थोड़ी सी प्रॉब्लम है, उन्होंने सर्वर चेंज किया है, लेकिन वो हम आपके लिए क्रिएट कर सकते हैं जो बाहर के लोग हैं। अब देखिए ये यहाँ पर अब मैं सर्च कर सकता हूँ जो भी मान लीजिए फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन वगैरह पे, और इस पर मैं एक चीज़ और आपको दिखाना चाह रहा था, सर्च इस पर नज़र नहीं आ रही है। ठीक है, तो एक चीज़ यह है कि इस पर्टिकुलर डेटाबेस में जो आपको फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन पे चाहिए वो आपको यहाँ से सर्च करके बहुत आसानी से मिल जाएगा।
लेकिन इट इज सर्चिंग ओनली ईपीडब्ल्यू।
हाँ तो मैं चाहती हूँ
कि कोई आर्टिकल ईपीडब्ल्यू में आया हो, कोई आर्टिकल टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया में, इकोनॉमिक टाइम्स में आया हो, कोई किताब भी हो, तो हाँ, मुझे आई वॉन्ट एवरीथिंग इन वन।
देखिए उसके लिए एक सर्विस है जो कहलाती है डिस्कवरी सर्विस, और वो डिस्कवरी सर्विस ये करती है कि जितने भी हमारे रिसोर्सेज हैं, चाहे वो ई जर्नल्स, ई बुक्स, हमारा कैटलॉग, वो सबको एक में इंटीग्रेट कर देती है। और जब आप एक सिंगल सर्च विंडो आता है और आप उस सिंगल सर्च विंडो पे अगर जब फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन लिखेंगी तो चाहे वो जर्नल आर्टिकल हो, चाहे ई बुक हो, चाहे हमारे कैटलॉग में कोई किताब हो, सब नज़र आ जाएगा। लेकिन उसकी थोड़ा सा उसकी हमारे पास वो है नहीं, और इसलिए नहीं है कि वो काफ़ी एक्सपेंसिव है, यानी तकरीबन 10 लाख रुपए साल का है। तो ये चीज़ हमारे वहाँ जब मैं आईएम इंदौर में था तो हमने ये चीज़ वहाँ पर इम्प्लीमेंट की थी, लेकिन ठीक है वो इसलिए भी वहाँ इसलिए देखिए ज़रूरी थी आईएम जैसी जगह पर कि वहाँ पर हमारे पास तकरीबन 23-24 जो है वो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक जर्नल्स के डेटाबेस सब्सक्राइब करते थे, तो इट वॉज प्रैक्टिकली यू नो डिफिकल्ट टू सर्च ऑल द डेटाबेसेस फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर टर्म, से फॉर एग्जाम्पल फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन, बट हियर इन अवर केस इन केस ऑफ मानू वी हैव वेरी लिमिटेड नंबर ऑफ डेटाबेसेस, सो देर इज नो हार्म इन गोइंग एंड सर्चिंग इन दोज 3-4 डेटाबेसेस वॉट एवर वी हैव। बट
आई गो टू जे स्टोर, तो जे स्टोर से मुझे मिल जाता है।
हाँ हाँ
जेस्टोर में इस्तेमाल करती हूँ।
करेक्ट, तो वहाँ वो भी अगर आप देखेंगे तो वो भी हमने उस पर जेस्टोर में तो आपको मिल जाएगा। और दूसरी अगर आपको चीजें अगर नीचे टेलर में फ्रांसिस है और शायद वाइली भी है उसमें
आप मेंडली, मेंडली, मेंडली पर,
हाँ मेंडली का देखिए, मेंडली में आपको दिखाया था। देखिए इसमें जैसे ये मैंने मेंडली खोला और यहाँ पर कहाँ है वो, देखिए ये एक यहाँ पर है लेफ्ट साइड पे लिटरेचर सर्च।
मेंडली में भी आपको अकाउंट खोलना पड़ता है, फिर उसमें आप रख सकते हैं ये लिस्ट जो बनाई आपने, जो इससे पहले पेज दिख रहा
जी,
था।
जी जी,
तो ये
हाँ, तो मैं ये करता हूँ, मैं ये करता हूँ अक्सर के जब जैसे मान लीजिए मैंने जब कॉपीराइट या उस पर बताता हूँ आपको, मैं
मेंडली में आपने अकाउंट खोला
बिल्कुल,
फिर उसमें वो सेव करते हैं, तो दे नीड टू ओपन एन अकाउंट इन मेंडली।
बिल्कुल, आपको वो क्रिएट करना पड़ेगा क्योंकि ये चीज जो है वो ये रेफरेंस ऑर्गेनाइजर है एक्चुअली ये, मतलब अब मैं आपको एक
तो इस मेंडली पर जाने के लिए डू वी नीड टू गो थ्रू यू और वी कैन डायरेक्टली गो?
नो नो नो, दिस इज अवेलेबल इन
डायरेक्ट
यू जस्ट, दिस इज एल्सेवियर प्रोडक्ट व्हिच इज अवेलेबल फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट, सो यू कैन जस्ट सर्च ऑन इन गूगल मेंडली and okay. you will get the link to install it, but my suggestion is that before that if you can just see that video on Mendeley, so you will save a lot of time in understanding that.
ठीक है, fine.
इसमें देखिए IPR पे मैंने बहुत सारी जो पे कुछ चीजें, तो जो जो चीजें मुझे IPR पे मिलती रही, देखिए मैं ना इसमें जैसे COVID-19 में ना,
जी exactly.
इसके अलावा वीडियोस जो जो मुझे मिलते गए, तो इसमें सबसे अच्छी चीज मेंडली में ये है देखिए कि जैसे मैंने बताया आपको, पहली चीज तो ये कि आपको इसके अंदर वो नहीं करना है क्या कहते हैं आपको डाटा इनपुट नहीं करना है, ये आप ऑटोमेटिकली सारा जो है कैप्चर कर लेगी बिब्लियोग्राफिक डिस्क्रिप्शन।
ओके गुड
हाँ, इसमें दूसरी चीज इंपॉर्टेंट चीज ये है कि जैसे ये वेबसाइट मैंने खोली है, ठीक है देख रही हैं आप, ये YouTube का वीडियो है, पे वीडियो है, और इसके अलावा अगर कोई आर्टिकल होता तो भी वही प्रोसेस होता। तो मैं यहाँ पर क्या करूंगा कि यहाँ पर देखिए मेंडली का छोटा सा बटन नजर आ रहा है अगर आप लोगों को, यहाँ क्लिक करता हूँ मेंडली पे, तो एक ये देखिए यहाँ खुल जाएगा एक वो, ठीक है, और ये चीज है एक्चुअली कुछ अकेडमिक पब्लिशिंग के ऊपर। तो मैं यहाँ पर देखिए एथिक्स इन राइटिंग है, यहाँ पर मेरा ऑलरेडी एक वो है तो मैं क्या करूंगा इस पर्टिकुलर चीज को ये यहाँ ऐड कर दूंगा, जब मैं ऐड कर दूंगा
इट विल गो टू दैट लिस्ट। आई सी ओके आई अंडरस्टूड नाउ।
लेकिन ये हो सकता है कि आपको के फॉरन ना दिखाए वो, तो क्योंकि इसको थोड़ा सा सिंक करना पड़ता है एक बार, तो अगर आप सिंक करेंगे इसको एक बार और यहाँ पर सिंक हो गया, अब मैं इसको
ऐड करेंगे,
ये देखिए ये एक मिनट, ये देखिए अभी लिख के आ रहा है 5:27 पे मैंने ये वाला वीडियो
जी ओके
ये बड़ी खूबसूरती है इसकी।
हाँ वेरी नाइस, तो यू नीड टू क्रिएट अ फोल्डर फर्स्ट?
नो, यू नीड टू फर्स्ट इंस्टॉल मेंडली।
हाँ नहीं, वो तो हाँ मेंडली ओके वो तो करना ही होगा जी।
Then if you want to, if you are working on say diminishing marginal, क्या है वो?
Utility. diminishing marginal utility.
तो मान लीजिए उस पे कुछ कर रही है तो आप एक चैप यहाँ पर फोल्डर खोल लीजिए।
हाँ, एक फोल्डर।
हाँ, इसके अलावा एक इसमें बहुत अच्छी चीज ये है कि इसमें ऑलरेडी एक फोल्डर बन के आता है माय पब्लिकेशन। जितने भी आपके छपे हुए पब्लिकेशन है वो आप डाल सकती है अगर बाई चांस यहाँ से साइट करना है। इसके अलावा अगर आप ये चीज अपने APA स्टाइल या जो भी स्टाइल में कन्वर्ट करके अपने CV में भी ऐड कर सकती हैं। एक्चुअली ये काफी अच्छा सिस्टम है अगर इसको ठीक से एक्सप्लोर किया जाए।
वेरी गुड आप बहुत 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 अच्छा, बहुत अच्छा रियली। आपसे मैं यहाँ एक और ये रिक्वेस्ट करूंगी कि आप अभी बोल रहे थे ना अपने लेक्चर के दौरान के आपको मेल किया जाए और फिर आप किसी वीडियो का लिंक भेजेंगे, तो मैं यहाँ रिक्वेस्ट करूंगी कि आप बराए मेहरबानी वो मुझे भेज दें। आई विल शेयर विद द पार्टिसिपेंट्स।
आई विल सेंड यू।
ये बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है और बहुत जरूरी है कि हमारे यंग कलीग्स अभी से इसको इस्तेमाल करना शुरू कर दें.
वेरी यूजफुल एक्चुअली, आई टेल यू,
वेरी यूजफुल.
इसमें आप लोग काफी टाइम अपना बचाएंगे और जो दूसरे जो रिसर्च स्कॉलर जो जल्दी लिखते हैं ना आर्टिकल, वो इसलिए लिख पाते हैं, उनका आईटी अच्छा होता है जरा. सो दे वेस्ट देयर टाइम इन ऑल दीस थिंग्स.
बेहद शुक्रिया आपका कि आपने अपने कीमती वक्त से हमारी एक एक रिक्वेस्ट पर आपने लबैक कहा और आप तशरीफ लाए टॉक के लिए. बेहद शुक्रिया.
बस शुक्रिया.